Theological Seminary, and welcome. Thank you all for joining us today. Today is another session of Knowledge and Nourishment. These are webinars that we've put on all summer long. We started actually in late spring, but today we have a really great treat for you, and we're so excited that you have chosen to join us. We guarantee that we will be done by 11 o'clock. Many of you, I know, would like to go on, including us, and watch the funeral procession and service of the Honorable Congressman John Lewis. So we will be done by 11 a.m. Today, Serene is joined by David Fankhauser. You'll see me throughout the program only because David and I have been friends for over a decade. And David was one of the original freedom riders along with John Lewis. And he actually served in Parchment Farms, a prison with him. But he'll talk a lot more about that. Let me just go through a little bit of quickly his biography. And then we'll get right to the interview and the conversation that the three of us are going to have today. Serene Jones is our president, as you all know, and she will start with, as we normally do, with a little bit of an update of Union Theological Seminary, although it is a quiet summer. But first, David. Dr. David B. Fankhauser is a professor retired of biology and chemistry from the University of Cincinnati. He has did his PhD in 1971 in biology at the Johns Hopkins University, which is where he and I met. David also spent his first 2 years as an undergraduate student in 1959 at Central State College, which is a UNBC, which is a school of a Black school. And he went from there on to complete his BA at Erne College in Richmond, Indiana. He has received numerous awards and honors, right? He's won awards for effective teaching, outstanding relationships and lab programs that he created, and websites supporting his teaching. He was honored in 2014 for the Ohio State Civil Rights Hall of Fame. He was inducted into that in the State House ceremony. In 2011, he was the Ohio Teacher of the Year. That was granted by Ohio Magazine. In 2011, he received a letter of recognition from President Barack Obama on the 50th anniversary of the Freedom Rides. 2010. He received an award, the highest award at the University of Cincinnati for promoting good student and faculty relations. And it goes on and on and on. He's also a homesteader and he makes amazing cheese. I've had some of that and really great breads that I'm sure he's doing a lot of that now. He's married to Jim Fankhauser. They met at Hopkins, I believe. I know she did her master's, mm-hmm. right? And they have children and grandchildren. But without further ado, I present to you David Fankhauser, and we'll start the interview today with our president, Serene Jones.
Thank you, Rita, so much for all that you do for that introduction and for bringing David into this conversation this morning. Just so our audience is aware, our own Executive Vice President, Fred Davey, is in Atlanta now for the memorial service. The actual service is quite small. And I myself had the opportunity to meet Representative Conscience of the Nation, John Lewis, when I was speaking at the Congressional Black Caucus 5 years ago about housing. And he came up to me afterwards. We had about an hour actually to talk. And he began by expressing his deep appreciation for Union and for the legacy of Union and all that Union has done and all the people from Union that he met initially during the Freedom Rides. And that's why today our wonderful special guest is so important to honoring that legacy, because it's impossible to understand John Lewis without understanding the deep roots of the activism and the cost to his own life and the kind of spirit and soul that he had that allowed him to sustain his activism and his prophetic voice all these years. We've lost a great man. So I'm just very pleased to have this conversation this morning in his honor. A brief word about Union. Things are quiet here in late July as we prepare to have a different kind of school year. We'll be starting our school year with a month-long set of intensive courses in September, all of which will be done remotely. And then beginning in October, on October 5th, we'll start our first semester, which will also be done remotely. We have finished the renovation of Hastings Hall, so we will have students living safely on campus in residences that follow all of the health department standards and have room for quarantine. And we've worked very hard to make sure the campus is safe, and we're excited to welcome an entering class that of over 80 students. So we're looking forward to the adventures of the year ahead. Now back to our conversation this morning. It strikes me often in conversations with my own daughter, who's now 24, how particularly now that we are in the rising tide of the Black Lives Matters movement, we hear reference to the 60s and the civil rights movement, and we hear thrown around this word called the freedom rides and people who were freedom riders. But rarely do we take time to stop and actually explain. David, you were in that early wave of freedom riders. What does that even mean alongside John Lewis that you began your own activist career that way?
Well, of course, at the time, I first met John Lewis in the home of Ralph Abernathy, where I was hiding out in Montgomery. And at that same home was Martin Luther King and a number of other the leaders, Jim Farmer, who founded CORE. And I did not know who John Lewis was, but I knew this was a young man with a large white bandage on the back of his head, where he had been beaten when he arrived in Montgomery. But I was very impressed with him at that point as being, I like to use the analogy of deep streams run smooth, that he was calm, it was intense, he was committed, but he was deeply committed, as were all of us in that room, including especially Martin Luther King, to the principle of nonviolence and nonviolent resistance. And he has been committed to that all through his life. I was very impressed with his presence. Again, I was introduced to him as that he was John Lewis, but when we finally met 2.5 weeks later in Parchman State Penitentiary, they kept calling him Bob, and I didn't know who Bob was, but it turns out he's John Robert Lewis, and his friends call him Bob at that point. So I met him in Abernathy's house in the presence of Martin Luther King, interesting enough.
So together you were, that bandage on his head came because he was along with you and many others doing freedom rides. Can you just explain briefly to us what those were?
Yes, the freedom rides were a demonstration organized by Jim Farmer, who was the head of the Congress of Racial Equality. And in 1946, Irene Morgan was arrested in Virginia for refusing to move to the back of a bus on an interstate bus. The Supreme Court ruled that that was unconstitutional and that in fact, interstate facilities were required to be integrated. Well, that was 1946. Now it's 1961 and the South is flagrantly segregated. And so the demonstration was intent on taking public buses, tramways and Greyhound from New York City to New Orleans. And as it went through the South, the integrated group would get off the bus, integrate the waiting room, and then get back on the bus and proceed to the next town. There were no serious problems, although there was a brief skirmish and an arrest in South Carolina. But in Atlanta, Martin Luther King said that he had heard rumors that the Ku Klux Klan had a welcoming party for the Freedom Riders when they arrived in Alabama. And it was on Mother's Day, May 20th, that the Greyhound bus arrived in Anniston, Alabama, where the tires were slashed. The bus managed to escape out of the bus station, but about 6 miles outside of Anniston, the tires went flat. The Ku Klux Klan followed in cars, broke open the window, threw a firebomb into the bus, and everybody's probably seen the pictures of this burning Greyhound bus. That was the fate of the Greyhound bus. John Lewis was on the Trailways bus, and they were in front. They had not heard what had happened in Anniston. And when his bus arrived in Birmingham, there was a mob waiting. The Bull Connor, the police chief, had given the Ku Klux Klan 15 minutes to exert punishment on the Freedom Riders. So there was a 15 minutes of beating, during which time John Lewis was beaten. Then when the police came in, interestingly, they didn't arrest any of the mob, they arrested all the Freedom Riders, which is sort of, we see a pattern similar to that today, I'm sorry to say. So then John Lewis was beaten there. Then he got back on the bus in Birmingham and went to Montgomery. And in spite of the fact that Bobby Kennedy had sent John Siegenthaler to observe, he had gotten a promise from the governor of Alabama that the Freedom Riders would be protected. But in fact, again, the same thing happened that had happened in Birmingham. That was that there was a mob waiting. That was when John Lewis got a severe head wound from a lead pipe that he was struck with. And other Freedom Riders were hospitalized as a result of that. So that's how he got that wound on his head in Montgomery. And it was at that point that Jim Farmer said, "This is much too dangerous. We're calling this off. Somebody's going to get killed." So the young students in Fisk University in Nashville, most notably, one of my heroines is Diane Nash, said, "We can't stop now. We have a momentum. We have the attention of the world. We must keep these going." And so SNCC picked up the baton and said, we're going to keep these going. And it was at that point that Diane Nash called to Black colleges around the eastern part of the United States, asking for volunteers to come and replace those Freedom Riders that had been injured. And I was going to a Black college, a Central State College in Wilberforce, Ohio at the point. And so I got that call, and I was a 19-year-old and not much appreciation for my own mortality. I said, "I'm going, this is something I really want to do." And I immediately that night flew down to Montgomery and was whisked to Ralph Abernathy's home. I say whisk because when I was picked up at the airport, the Black man that picked me up said, "Follow me, but keep 20 feet behind." So I followed him to his station wagon. When we got there, he said, "Lie down on the back so they don't see you." We went to Abernathy's house. I have to say, one of the remarkable things, it was now 8 o'clock in the morning, and May 24th, and sitting on the couch in his pajamas and smoking a cigarette was Dr. Martin Luther King. And he was, we knew him then, but he wasn't nearly as famous as now, but he was deeply involved in the planning of the Freedom Rides. So that was, that gets us to Montgomery, and it was in that context that I first met John Lewis.
David, can you talk a little bit about how the strategy changed once you arrived in Montgomery?
Yes, well, it was a major change that happened. Actually, one of the things that happened was the day that I arrived, that I flew in, the National Guard was called out. And because the government said, "That's enough, these beatings, we can't have that anymore." And so we were greeted with National Guard with fixed bayonets around the bus stations. And in a sense, although I'm fundamentally a pacifist, I did not mind seeing that there was a barrier between the white mobs and those of us that were freedom riders. Now, so what then happened, there was a group at Abernathy's house led by William Sloan Coffin, who was the chaplain at Yale, and there were 13 Yale divinity students. And they did not want the rest of us to join. They thought it would be more impact if they were all Yalies that were getting, they were taking the freedom ride. So they took the bus ride to Jackson, where they were immediately arrested. And it was clear that the South strategy had changed. It was, beatings was not working out very well for them. The PR was terrible. So Mississippi thought, if we just lock them up, that'll take care of it. And once they're all in jail, then it won't, no more freedom rides. Well, that night in Abernathy's house, and it was quite a remarkable, at Abernathy's dining room table, Martin Luther King, Jim Farmer, John Lewis, and a number of other of us decided that because they were clear on arresting us, we thought, okay, the new policy is going to be jail, no bail. In other words, we're going to fill up Mississippi jails. And so from then on, we would ride, freedom riders would ride the bus from Montgomery to Jackson and would be immediately arrested, put in jail. And it took us about 10 or 12 days to fill up both the city jail and the county jail. And it was that point that they transferred all of us to Parchman State Penitentiary, maximum security unit, death row.
Bit about that experience, what happened once you arrived at Parchman?
Well, Parchman, I thought, because we had been kind of lazing away in the city jail, doing nothing, just, you know, all day long doing nothing. When I heard we were going to Parchman, which is also known as Parchman Farm, and if you're familiar with blues songs, there are a lot of songs about Parchman Farm, I thought, this is great. We'll be out chopping cotton and that'd be more interesting. No, we were in fact totally isolated from the rest of the prison population at Parchman. I think in part because, of course, as you're not surprised to know, about 90% of the population are Black. And I don't think they wanted freedom riders out agitating among the prison population. So we were immediately put in maximum security unit, where we were locked up 24/7. We got out of our cells twice a week for showers, but that was the only time. There was no exercise. It was interesting. One of the things that happened was in Jackson, all the whites were put in the city jails and the Blacks were put in the county jail. So we were separated. But once we removed the Parchman, although the cells were still segregated, the cell block was integrated. And so we had about 26 freedom riders, about equal Black and white, maybe a few more Blacks. But that was the first time that we really were in an integrated group. And that's when I met more, at least became familiar with the voices of these other people. We would only see them for seconds as they walked by the cell on the way to the showers. But John Lewis, Stokely Carmichael, Jim Farmer, these were all my alumni of the maximum security unit in Parchman.
And David, I know that in reading about your experience that for those 42 days that you were in there, mm-hmm. You all, Stokely Carmichael, Jim Farmer, John Lewis, spent the days talking back and forth to each other through the cell block, even though you couldn't see each other, you could talk. And
that's correct. It was wonderful.
Non-violence versus violence. And I imagine just amazing conversations through those cell blocks. Tell us.
Of course, again, some of us were deeply committed to nonviolence. Stokely Carmichael was not. You may know or that he is the one that invented the term Black Power. And he was convinced that freedom for Black Americans would not come without violent struggle. And so we had these long philosophical discussions about, he saw nonviolence as a technique, but not as a fundamental goal. While those of us committed really to the principles of Mahatma Gandhi, that nonviolence is the only way to changing to a harmonious society. And then one of the humorous things that 50 years later, now Stokely had died previously, but his cellmate, Hunter Green, came up to me and said, "You know, Stokely and I wrote a song about you." And I said, "You did? Sing it for me. I want to hear it." He said, "No, I could not sing it." I said, "Oh, come on, give me." So in a sense, I'm just as glad I didn't hear it, because now I can use my imagination about this satirical song that they wrote about this pacifist Fankhauser. But
how amazing.
Oh. David, with apologies to Krista Tippett, I would like to ask you a question she always asks of her audiences. How did your religious upbringing really influence you and your participation in the movement? You mentioned that you were a Quaker.
Yeah, that is a good question. My mother was deeply involved in interracial, interreligious activities. She was a member of something called Fellowship of Reconciliation, which in Muncie, Indiana, where she was a college student. And I remember we went to picnics that were integrated. And I remember getting hostile reactions from other attendees of the parks because we were an integrated group, which was unheard of. Now, this would have been probably 1946, I would guess. We attended Friends Meeting, and I I like to say I was reared in the Quaker tradition. I'm not a joiner so much, so I'm not an official member, but I've been always associated with Quakers and Quaker meetings, and graduated from Earlham College, which is also a Quaker college. But Quakers have a long history of nonviolence, of social activism, and that it clearly had a major formative effect on my life. But I have to say, Quakers, there's a phrase, there is that of God in every man. And I think that really sums it up. And they were abolitionists, strong abolitionists in the early 19th century. And they campaigned for reform in prisons, reform in mental institutions. They've been very active in progressive causes for society.
And just two little connections here. The Fellowship of Reconciliation had its roots at Union amongst.
Is that right?
Who were conscientious objectors. We had the honor 3 years ago of giving our Union Medal to C.T. Vivian and Diane Nash.
C.T. Vivian was one of the people in Abernathy's house. And Diane Nash, I love her to death. And I think she's only now beginning to get the credit that she deserves. And I'm gonna just continue this thought. Even the civil rights movement, who is so concerned about equal rights, the leadership was all male and the women were doing the work. And I think that includes Diane Nash. She just worked endlessly. And again, the Freedom Rides, I would not have been there, and the Freedom Rides would not have continued without her effort. So I take my hat off to her. She's a heroine of mine.
Amazing woman.
Amazing. Just a moment, I wanted to just say to our audience who are watching, please start submitting your questions in the chat. We plan to get to all of them. There will be questions on Facebook. We'll actually want to address those as well. So just want to make sure you know that there's plenty of time for Q&A, and we appreciate your questions. David, can you talk a little bit about attending an HBCU in the 50s? And so a HBCU is a historically Black college and or university. And I think I It's a little bit nervous when we started, so I think I mixed up the letters a bit here, but my son attended.
It's right. Yeah, I know, that's all right.
Yeah.
I knew what you meant.
Yes. If you will, please.
You broke up there a little bit. Talk about the Central State and why I went.
To attend an HBCU.
Okay. So my family, again, was strongly anti-war. And so they intentionally lived below the poverty limit so they would not have to pay war taxes. That means we had no resources to go to college. Now, a philosophy professor at Central State, Ralph Templeton, was friends with my parents and also a group called Peacemakers out of Cincinnati. And he said, well, you know, Central State is trying to get some white students to come in. And they have financial assistance if you were interested in coming. And so with the combination of a scholarship and a student work project and a loan, I was able to go to Central State. So I went there in part because I could, and in part because I was deeply committed to integration and I liked the idea of contributing to that. By the way, I think it was an amazing experience, educational experience in a social setting, because unless someone has been a minority, they have no idea what it's like to be a minority and stand out. I mean, it's, you know, you can't pretend that you're, I couldn't pretend that I was Black, but I did feel welcomed. My roommates were very good. I have to give one little incident that happened. I'd been there probably 3 weeks and I cut myself while I was doing work in the kitchen. And I went to the infirmary and they bandaged it up and they put a Band-Aid on. It was a flesh colored Band-Aid, but not the color of my flesh. Mm. And I thought, how does it feel to be a person when everything is set up for a person of a different color than you are? And that kind of gave me insight into what it's like to be a minority. But Central State, I was a chemistry major and I was happy to be there, but I have another interesting incident there. Out of 2000 students, 8 of us were white. And all of us that had gone, all of the white students, clearly were interested in integrating society, but where did we sit in the cafeteria? We all sat at the same table. It's this, the cultural thing is very potent, and it wasn't because we didn't feel welcome at other tables, and we didn't always do that, but it was not unusual that we would be sitting in one table. And I noticed that also, that Black students often in the cafeteria will sit at the same table. And it's easy for people to assume, well, that's because they don't want to have anything to do with the rest of us. But that, from my experience, it wasn't that at all. It's just social comfort, really, that you're with people of the same cultural background.
I want to bring us back to the music that—
Oh, yes.
And how that played a role in the Freedom Rides.
All right. Well, it was of enormous importance to me and I think to the whole movement. One of the things that happened when we were transferred to Parchman, again, now we're an integrated group on a given cell block. And I like to say, only partly tongue in cheek, that the Black Freedom Riders taught us white boys how to sing. And we sang and we sang and we sang. And the freedom songs, of course, are derived from spirituals. And the spirituals are really protest songs against slavery. And so they're very easily adapted into freedom songs. And I firmly believe that the songs represent the heart and soul of the movement as I experienced it, because it brought us together in a common cause. It was a positive, uplifting reassurance that we're doing something of value. And of course the guards hated it. And they engaged in quite a serious campaign to try to get us to stop singing, which I can go into if you're interested.
Well, Well, you know, I've heard that story before, so I would love for you to share it with others because I found it very, very interesting.
Okay. So they said, the first thing, guards came in and said, we can't have this. All that noise is bothering the cooks. Now, we're already laughing because the cooks, you know, you get it. So, yeah. Well, it's just for the same reason they didn't want to send the general population at Parchman. So the cooks were all black, and you know that they were not being bothered in the sense. So they said, we've got to stop it. You must stop singing. And so when we were put in our cells, all we were given was an underpants and a t-shirt, a Bible and a toothbrush. That's all we had. We never got clothes. And so they said, if you don't stop singing, we're going to take away your toothbrush. So we said, okay, I guess we won't brush our teeth for a while. If you don't stop singing, we're going to take away your Bibles. Now Bibles. So, and half of the Freedom Riders were ministers already. So we didn't really need Bibles. We were very familiar with the scriptures and could recite them endlessly. Then they said, well, if you don't stop singing, we're still singing, we're going to take away your mattresses. And they pulled the mattresses. And so now we're sleeping on plate steel bunks without sheets or without mattresses. Then they turned the water off so we couldn't flush the toilet. Now this is in the Mississippi Delta, which is known for being very hot, very humid. And the toilets got quite stinky pretty quickly. Then they took the screens off the windows. And of course, the lights are on 24 hours a day. So at night, with the screens off the windows, the Mississippi insects came swarming into the cell block. And we were just really bitten up like crazy. So then at 2 o'clock in the morning, when the guards changed, one of the guards said, oh, look at all them bugs. We're going to have to spray. So about an hour later, we hear a big truck pull up outside the window, and this hose, it looked like a fire hose, was threaded in through the window, and they completely drenched the whole cell block with us trapped in our cells with DDT. So that was pretty, I'm not sure that we were still singing at that point. That was pretty much the depth of despair in terms of that. Well, the next morning, the guard came in, the warden of the whole prison came in, and he was standing right outside my cell, so I could see this. He smoked a pipe, and he was trying to fill his pipe, and he was shaking so much that the tobacco was falling on the floor. He said, now, boys, we don't need all this mess. We're going to give you all your stuff back, but you have to stop singing. I said, no, we will not stop singing. Well, just tone it down a little bit. So they gave us all these things back. We're thinking, what's going on? That afternoon, there were four people dressed very nattily in suits, men and women. And it turns out that the governor of Minnesota had sent a delegation to see how the Freedom Riders were being treated. Four of the Freedom Riders were from Minnesota. And thank goodness for that delegation. I don't know what would have happened after. I mean, how much more could they have escalated? But that was the reason they got all the stuff returned to us, because they couldn't have us in cells drenched with DDT and no mattresses and no water. So that things were restored after that. But that was... Now, some people were, in fact, beaten. I was never beaten, and nobody was beaten to my knowledge, but they did use wrist breakers and cattle prods when people didn't move fast enough.
So many of these stories are horrifying and shockingly present to us in this moment.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
As protesters are being picked off the street and put in bands and hauled away. Right. As people are infiltrating protest to try to escalate violence.
That's an important point that a lot of people don't realize. Thank you for that. Yeah.
And as we now have, a very multi-generational, multiracial movement happening. I think of
it's important
in Portland. Yeah. We're all watching Portland very closely, but I was particularly thinking about your experience in jail. And my nephew is is very active in Black Lives Matters in Oklahoma. In fact, that's where when I go to visit my father, who's in hospice, that's where I've been protesting. Was put in jail and came out covered from head to toe with bed bugs, so bad that.
Who was this?
This is my nephew.
Your nephew was.
Yeah, and now has started a sort of whole piece of the movement. There is just simply protesting the conditions under which people live in terms of just the bugs and the kind of harassment and torture that is.
Right.
And charging white protesters with misdemeanors and Black protesters as terrorists.
Right.
So the resonances are so powerful back and forth. And so, you know, what words do you have to say to all of us who are out there protesting at different levels and different ways now in this rising, powerful, amazing movement that's happening?
Well, I am thrilled to see streets filled, not just in one or two cities, but all across the nation, people filling the streets. And as you pointed out, these are completely integrated with respect to race, with respect to religion, with respect to age. I mean, it really is a wonderful movement. My biggest concern is that the provocateurs are triggering violence at the perimeter. And I plead from the depth of my heart that demonstrators retain their commitment to nonviolence, because all it takes is one or two people to respond with violence. And that's all the excuse that the authorities need to lay into us with batons and tear gas and whatnot. So adhere to the nonviolence. I think, remember the goal, at least I hope the goal is a more harmonious, equitable society. We're not looking for somebody to win and somebody to lose, but to a true integration in which people are brought into the society in an equitable way. And we are so far from equality in terms of financially, in terms of education, in terms of housing. I mean, it's really scandalous. And we're still suffering with the legacy of slavery. A lot of people say, slavery has been over for 150 years. But the legacy is as obscene as ever. I mean, I don't know how many people know what redlining is, but redlining occurred in the cities in the 1930s. And essentially what they did was draw a red line around the economically depressed areas. And those were all ghetto. And that red line meant that nobody was willing to invest in those houses, that's where the grocery deserts come from. And the legacy is still there. I mean, Cincinnati, Ohio still has this very segregated city with respect to housing. And that also then what that means is, because schools are funded by local taxes, that means the Black schools are way underfunded while the suburbanite schools are very well funded. And again, I firmly believe education is really the answer to successful integration. We've got to get quality education for all children. That's another my soapbox.
What gives you hope these days?
Oh, gives me hope. Well, all the people in the street. I mean, because, and the consciousness, and I think there's an interesting change that I think is also helpful. And that is, if you remember a year ago, you mentioned Black Lives Matter, and the majority of whites would dismiss them. Oh, they're just a bunch of terrorists, da, da, da. But that whole attitude has changed. And a lot of people are seeing that it is not, nobody's looking for special privileges, but the fact that you have to say Black Lives Matter means that for 400 years, Black lives have not mattered. And what we're really looking for is that, and the first step is consciousness raising, to realize what is going on. And I'm embarrassed to see white folk on Facebook with no clue that they really do in fact harbor racist attitudes. And I think we need to examine our lives and the intrinsic racism that is built into this society.
So what would you say to them in sort of one sentence or two? Say to those folks?
I, it's a very tough nut to crack. And I don't have an easy answer, but one of the things I say is that you need to put yourself in their shoes and imagine, because one of the things we need is empathy. And I think we're very short on empathy these days. We don't get much modeling of that from our administration, but to try to put yourself in the shoes and see that what that experience is like. And I talk about most whites now have learned what the talk is. But for years I would say during my Freedom Ride talks, I said, do you know what the talk is? And a lot of whites did not know that. But I said, can you imagine that you would have to warn your children when they go out to be bow and scrape and be very respectful to the cops and be very careful what you do, and that, or else you may not even come home. And so that the fact that Black parents have to give the talk, I will be glad when that's no longer necessary, but it certainly is still as necessary as ever. So I don't have an answer, but if I go back to my sort of Quaker nonviolent roots, and that is what we're looking for is to treat people with love instead of anger, and reach out and try to understand where these people are coming from and not criticize them for being bad people, but try to understand that they picked up this prejudice. They were raised in a milieu of prejudice, and it's difficult to get out of that, but it's going to be a slow process. But I wish I had an answer. I don't have the answer, but I do believe that emphasizing love, compassion, altruism, these are the better aspects of humanity, I would like to think, and those can bring us out of this difficult situation.
Thank you.
Oh, sorry, Serene. No, I was going to say thank you for that. And I know that John Lewis himself was always, held that tension between reminding people of how far we have come and how many lives were risked and given over to the struggle, and yet how far we have to go. And the hope lies in the tension of those two.
Yeah. I agree with that 100%. And some people would say, oh, no, we haven't come anywhere near far enough. But I think you have to be optimistic about the arc of history, that we're going in the right direction, and that you don't get, just because you see how much work to do doesn't mean you should be discouraged. I mean, we keep that optimism, that movement growing, but that the arc of history, I like that phrase, because we have come very far, and there's so much better, but just try to tell a Black family that everything's okay now. I'm sorry, it's not okay, but it's so much better than it was, and we're moving in the right direction, but we need to put the pedal to the metal on this. We're going way too slow. And
as a, as a Black mother, as a Black wife, as a Black woman, I agree with that it is hard to sort of celebrate progress, right?
Right.
Right. When they're, you put a knife in 12 inches, you pull it out.
Yeah.
Knife in their back. So to your point, I think it is such a good one, because while this isn't the time for celebration, this continues to be the time
for work.
Work that everybody can take part in.
Right.
So our humanity as people of color, Black people, brown people, and others, that humanity is on full display at all times.
Right.
So I'm always shocked and surprised when other folk don't see it. And yeah. I, as a person who was born in the Red Clay South, I like to say that I was born in Georgia, which is true, but I was potty trained in Alabama, right? So our parents, hospital in Georgia and took me across the That was 1964. So, you know, some of the things, while obviously I don't remember those things as a child, the experience of those things, but Serene talks in her research, talks a lot about grace and trauma. The trauma been passed down to me from my parents and grandparents remains with me.
Yeah.
I want to thank you for putting your body on the line all of those years ago, that it comes with deep admiration and appreciation.
Thank you.
And what you continue to do. I know you're 78 years old. You're not ashamed of that, and you tell it.
No, I'm not ashamed of that. I've earned it.
Right. Exactly. So I'm not talking out of turn, but I do appreciate that how you found ways to continue to morph into what civil disobedience is in the name of justice.
Right.
It is now.
I just want to say one last thing, Rita, to both Rita and David, that also your long and sustained friendship is itself a sign of hope and a sign of activism, and it shines a light on the future that we reach for. So I just want to celebrate the friendship that you two have had.
It is a treasure. It's a treasure to me, I can assure you. She's such a wonderful person.
And we're the Mutual Admiration Society. But now we have lots of people that I admire who are asking questions, and I want to make sure.
Okay, good.
Why don't we do this? Kevin, I'm sure that you can hear us. We have a little video. It's about 3 minutes long. We're going to show that video. So we're going to mute everyone, including ourselves. And then we'll get right to the questions, because I think some more questions may come out of seeing this 3-minute video and some of the images that people are familiar with, but maybe some they are not. Beforehand, I want to give thanks to Joe Letourneau, who's a colleague of ours who helped us put this together. I want to thank all of our development colleagues who are working so hard behind the scenes, and our community colleagues who make sure that all the apparatus runs correctly. So thank you, Ian, thank you, Robin, thank you, Kevin, Luke, Shana, and thank you, Jill. Right. So Kevin, if you wouldn't mind showing the video.
Alabama's got me so upset. Tennessee's made me lose my red. Everybody knows about Mississippi. Goddamn! Alabama's got me so upset. The whole world has made me lose my red. Everybody knows about Mississippi. Goddamn! Can't you see it? Can't you feel it? All in the air. I can't stand the pressure much longer. Somebody say a prayer. Alabama's got me so upset. Tennessee's made me lose my rest. Everybody knows about Mississippi. Goddamn! Hound dogs on my trail. Children sitting in jail. Black cat across my path. I think every day is gonna be my last. Lord, have mercy on this land of mine. We all gonna get it in due time. I don't belong here. I don't belong there. I've even stopped believing in prayer. Almost, but not quite. Don't tell me, I'll tell you. me and my people just about do. I've been there, so I know. They keep on saying, go slow. Well, that's just the trouble. Desegregation, mass participation, unification, do things gradually, gradually. Why don't you see it? Why don't you feel it? I don't know. You don't have to live next to me, love. Just give me my equality, love. All knows about Mississippi. Everybody knows about Alabama. Everybody knows about Mississippi. Oh,
thank you, Kevin. Thank you again, Joe, for helping us put that together. Thank you. You may have noticed some colleagues from Union there also who participated. So we just want to say thank you all for the work that you're doing and continue to do in the name of Black Lives Matter and in the name of humanity. I'd like to go through some of the questions now. We have about 9 minutes, and so we'll try. I'm going to ask about two at a time, and if you can just, David, answer probably two at a time, we'll try to
keep. I'll pick the one that I want to answer.
No. All right, we'll try to keep it brief and get to all of them. So Martha just said, where were the women freedom riders kept? That's her question. Stacy also has a question for David. First of all, thank you for your courage. My question is, did you ever have any doubts when you were on the Freedom Rides or when you were imprisoned that you had made the wrong decision to join? If you did, how did you overcome that doubt?
I'll answer the second one first. I never felt I did the wrong thing. That doesn't mean I wasn't afraid or apprehensive. I'll tell you, the time that I was most fearful was in Montgomery. There were white people coming in, freedom riders coming in by train, and I was sent to the train station to pick them up. And I was very paranoid that everybody knew I was a freedom rider. And the only people I really trusted were blacks that were in that area. Now, so that's that. Now, the other thing in that video you just showed, there was a picture of the maximum security unit. I don't know if you remember seeing that, but the men were in the right-hand cell block and the women were in the left-hand cell block. So we never saw them, of course, but that's where they were. But of course, prisons, they're not co-ed. So once we were arrested, I never saw them again until we got out.
Jan has a question. Charles Sherrod. I was a student at Union when I was there in the 1960s. I recall when Charlie went south with other Union students and was beaten within an inch of his life. Mm-hmm. A few years ago, Charlie received Union's Medal of Honor. Yet another Union student and my mentor is Reverend Richard Leonard. Richard was the only Unitarian Universalist minister to walk all the way across the Edmund Pettus Bridge in 1965. Mm-hmm. Years ago, he wrote a treasure of a book called I Witnessed Selma. What are your recollections on these individuals, both of whom emerged from the historic Union family? Shout out to Union.
Well, I don't know them personally, but I certainly have heard that they have been made major contributions to the history of civil rights, and I'm grateful for that. But I don't know them personally. Other than they are an honor to Union, beyond that, I don't know them personally.
So Shana has a question here. David, will you be writing a book about these experiences? It was really wonderful to learn about your time as a freedom rider and how it relates to what's going on today.
That is an embarrassing question. A number of people have said that I should write a book, and it's not that I don't have time to, but it's that motivation. And I think one of the problems is it would be a huge project, and I have to focus on piece by piece by piece rather than try to think about the whole thing. But I think I should. I think there's a lot to be said that needs to be brought out that people are not aware of. But thank you for that impetus, and who knows, that's another, that's a push to get me moving here.
David, do you want to say a little something? We're about 4 minutes out now before we have to say goodbye to one another. Do you want to say a little bit something about today and how you plan to spend the rest of the day?
This very day, like everybody else, not everybody else, but we're in semi-lockdown. So we have not been going out. We're missing all of our friends, but I'm fortunate enough to live on this little farm. And so I will be gardening I just baked some bread. I have some milk that I need to turn into cheese. So there's, I'm keeping busy, but what I miss most of all though is the social contact. And I was telling probably you that this is the first time in my life that there's been a major social action going on that I have not been part of. But I think that at 78, I need to be careful about not getting exposed to the coronavirus, because I don't have any underlying health problems, but I watch it. I watch it on TV and applaud what I'm seeing, but I feel a little bit like, well, if it were in my neighborhood, I might still put on a mask and get out and do it, but I'm not going to. So other than that, I'm hoping it's going to rain, because it's been a drought here in Cincinnati and my garden is a little parched. Then I will just take a deep breath after this enjoyable conversation.
And how do you think you will continue to honor the memory of Congressman John Lewis?
Well, one of the things, I'm of mixed feelings about this, but these days, for better or for worse, Facebook has become a major means of that I use for communication. And I will do what I can to continue honoring his, I forgot. Well, of course, I'm certainly gonna watch the funeral, and I understand that Barack Obama is going to give the eulogy, which I look forward to very much. I believe one of the things that happened to this nation is that having a Black president pulled the mask off of our racist traditions. And I think that there was so much anger from him being elected president that is what triggered, I call it a white lash, that people were angry. And I think otherwise it doesn't make sense who we elected in the last election. And so I'm very troubled about the direction the nation's going in. And I think we're in peril at the moment. I hope we can have a peaceful transition to the next president. But I think we may need to get out in the streets just to ensure that we get a transition to a peaceful transition to another president. But that's kind of out of left field there. Maybe left field, literally.
Yeah. Would you like to have the last word? We're at 10:59.
Just thank you both. And thank everyone for joining the conversation and honoring the history of the Freedom Riders. All of those pictures we saw at the end, all those people who put their lives on the line. David, for you and for your contributions over the years to the struggle, and today especially, to the legacy of John Lewis.
And this may be a perfect way to end. There's a comment by Mrs. H. She says, "I just want to say thank you for this opportunity. My heart is filled today with knowledge and hope for the future. Thank you for all the hands that put this wonderful his, her story together and lesson together. And so, that, right? So we just want to say thank you on behalf of all of us for telling your truth and telling your story. And I look forward to our continued conversation.
Yes, indeed. Well, thank you. Thank you, Rita. And thank you, President Jones. It's been an honor and enjoyable. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for coming. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye.